Well, something that I would like to say is that I recently myself got married, and it wasn't easy to find somebody. Whatever works, do that. But the most important thing, I think, if you're looking to get married and if you're ready, tell your siblings, tell your friends, tell your parents, tell your grandparents, tell everybody you know, because in this society, the only way you get things done is when you network.
Is this a cultural taboo, though?
No, absolutely not. I think that you actually get around the fact that there's a cultural taboo, because in our culture, you know, being introduced to a spouse through a family member or through a friend is very acceptable. So, you know, you get around that idea that you shouldn't be talking to somebody of the opposite sex. There shouldn't be mixing. I, in fact, think it's something that's encouraged, certainly in my culture.
How do you guys feel about that? Your parents introducing you to somebody, and then you get to know each other. Do your parents know, you know, what sort of person you would be interested in? Atif, what do you think?
I just wanted to say that the onus is not only on the parents, right? Because our parents, they raise us, they feed us, they clothe us, they teach us right from wrong. After that, there was an off-air comment that wasn't said that was very good, actually, from a gentleman, Zarar. And he said that, you know, we all go out and we make our own decisions, right? If I want to, it's Friday night, I can either go to the mosque and, you know, see what function is going on, or I can go to the latest club, you know, what's happening. So we really have to realize what society we're living in and how we want to live. And after that, I think the issue, I'll say for myself personally, the issue is that, yeah, I go to York University, and I sometimes, my eyes slip and I see a sister and I'm like, I wouldn't mind, you know, getting to know her and seeing what she's all about.
So but how would you go about doing that? Would you just go up to her and say, "Assalamu alaikum, sister"?
Therein lies the problem. Oh. Therein lies the problem.
Really?
There was one time that I said salam to a sister on the bus. She didn't respond, and I never did it again. It was traumatizing. So I was like, okay, you know what? Approaching sisters is not a good idea.
Why wouldn't she respond? It's an interesting thought.
She obviously didn't know what my intention was, right? Maybe, you know, in living in today's society, I think that even, if anything, that perpetuated my thoughts of wanting to get to know her more, because she didn't even respond to my salam. That made me even more attracted to this girl, right?
You know what I mean? The forbidden fruit, huh?
In fact.
Yeah, the forbidden fruit, yeah, that's, no. But the
so
fact
how's that working out for you, Atif?
No, but therein lies the problem. I think that we need to have more avenues for brothers and sisters to get to know each other. Not just, yeah, the cultural taboos are there, but we're living in North America. We can't blame Middle Eastern culture and, you know, South Asian culture anymore. It's not to blame, because now we have, it's morphed into a new culture, and we need to move with the times. You don't have to, you know, create un-Islamic environments, and, you know, you can solve the problem without doing that. What do you need to do? You need to get together and you need to communicate. Main thing is communication. Now we're having it, you know, we're having shows to talk about the subject.
I think a lot of people don't realize that there are services within the community to facilitate exactly this, because as you said, you went on a bus, you don't know if she's looking to get married or if she's already married for all you know. I mean, there's a service in the community which I happen to be involved with, which is called the IMAP program, and we actually are main focus is to bring people together to get married, which we discussed last show, which I'm not going to get into now. The website will be on, but we have to realize that we can talk to our imam, we should talk to the people at our local mosque, because they should know people. They may have a program there that is just specifically there to facilitate people who want to get married, so at least you're not going into a position where somebody may not want to get married.
I'd like to bring a point we discussed earlier where I was really, is it un-Islamic that she answers back and she talks to you? Where at work she's talking to non-Muslim colleagues. You brought the issue up earlier, and you know, so here a Muslim brother saying assalamu alaikum and she's not answering, but probably at work she is talking to others and she's discussing, and is it a double standard?
Well, see, my experience is that I'm a professional and I've worked with many Muslim women who are also professionals, and when we do discuss issues, we
watch what you say in front of your wife.
Well,
she's
also a professional, so it's okay. But I see that when they're out of the community, when they're out behind the eyes of their parents and the community, they're very open and they're very comfortable communicating with men who are Muslim and non-Muslim, mind you, on a professional level. Now, the interesting thing is this: that the parents sometimes they reinforce this behavior. If their daughter has a good job, They're very proud to say that my daughter's working downtown. She has a fantastic job. But that same daughter, when she's amongst other Muslims, it becomes a taboo, you know, not to talk to other Muslim boys in front of other Muslim members.
You were going to respond to that? No.
Can I say something? Or? Just quickly, one point I'd like to say is, if When I was in law school, when I was working in a law firm, if a colleague came and spoke to me of the opposite sex, he was coming to speak to me just to have a general conversation. If a young Muslim gentleman came to speak with me when I was not ready to get married, I didn't want to encourage it because my first thought was that is what he wanted and that is what he was looking for. And this may have been one of the problems you faced, I don't know, but this is the way women do think. Like, that is something that, you know, men...
So you're saying we're more comfortable talking to non-Muslims because we know that it's not their intention.
How do you know it's not their intention?
Well, you don't, well, do you know, well, do you know, well, I was going to say, do you know that? I mean...
Yes, clearly, they're coming to speak to you, and it's purely platonic. I mean, if it's a colleague and coming to speak to you about, you know, case, or even make general conversation because you work in the same office, yes. If a young Muslim brother comes out of the blue to speak to you and say hello... I don't think he's looking to be friends, especially when I'm at a marriageable age. I know that, and that may make me very uncomfortable. And I don't want to, you know, encourage that type of... I may not want to encourage that type of attention.
So if we don't talk to brothers at work, let's just say Muslim brothers, and we're sort of... It's a cultural taboo to talk to them at family gatherings. That's where we'd run into most Muslim potential people. Then what are we left with? Then what happens? Living in a multi-religion, multicultural society, do we find a lot of Muslims maybe marrying outside of the religion? Is that happening more commonly?
I think that's what it's going to lead to, because if we're saying Muslim boys and girls should not talk to each other, if they talk to others, who are they going to fall in love with? We have to admit we're humans, we have feelings.
Look, one of the major conundrums right now is that you have that issue of, well, how you should approach someone or how you should talk to someone. We've discussed the issue of venues, but there's the whole, there are myriad of situations that you're in, and I think that you have to be mature enough to be able to handle them and understand that you're not children at the same time. I think that's at some points that some people feel very uncomfortable with it, but I think that you have to be able to adjust and realize when you should be speaking to someone. And I think there's sometimes some people, like you said, maybe have some preconceived notions. I think not all guys are out there to, like, you know, get a Muslim girl's number. Maybe it's just like a camaraderie thing, like, hey, you know, what's up? I'm Muslim, you're Muslim, you know, it's just making friends. It's not like, when, like Freud said, sometimes a cigar is just a cigar. That's just mm-hmm. all it is.
But why is it that thought that it's not Islamic that a man talk to a woman? Within Islam, it is allowed so long as it's a respectable discussion, right? And this is an important thing, like this thing that's ingrained in some of us that it is not allowed. This is.
But I don't think it's not ingrained in us. I mean, I think that's a problem. It's not ingrained in the youth. I think that's more of the parents, and not all parents, but society as a whole. If you're seen talking to a girl, or a girl is talking to a guy, all of a sudden there's an issue of character. I mean, it's not considered socially apropos, if you will. I mean, that's what's problematic, and people don't want to dishonor their family, if you will.
Why can't we get over this?
I think it is, to a point, parents, but I also think it's other Muslims, too, or other youth, too. I remember a lot of a situation in university where you'd have a brother and sister walking together and talking, and already all the other Muslims think, oh, no, they're talking in the cafeteria. It could have turned out that they were brothers and sisters, or they could have been married, or there could have been so many other scenarios. So I think it's the first thing people think is, why are they doing that? But if she was talking to somebody in her class about some biology assignment, as her brother mentioned, in the workplace it's okay, but with other Muslims it's not. I think it should be that if a Muslim says Assalamu alaikum to another Muslim, you should feel safe that it's a Muslim that's talking to me, because we are one big family, we're all brothers and sisters. So we should be comfortable with someone saying Assalamu alaikum to us, and we're saying Wa alaikum assalam, instead of thinking that, oh, maybe they want to marry me, or maybe they want something from me, or have some other preconceived notions, which is natural that people have them, but I think we should try to eliminate these things out of our mind.
We also have the issue of people being in the masjid and the whole segregation, and how the masjids don't even promote the interaction between males and females. And I think that's where we have to start, probably outside of home, after home. It would be at the masjids, where the imams and the leaders of the community have to somehow be able to promote interaction within our youth, so that they're not left at the age of 30 trying to scramble and find a spouse.
But do you think, as young people, we're living a double standard? In a way, we're saying at the masjid, this is the environment, but outside in life, there's a different environment. And how does it make you feel as a young person?